Hi, you're watching New York State Legislative Report with Senator Mark Grisanti. I'm Julia Locandy. Today, the Senator and I are going to talk about what's going on in the New York State Senate. It's great to be with you, Senator.
Good to be here again. Talk about the budget.
Yeah. Before we talk about the budget, though, I heard a beloved member of the Buffalo Sabres passed away.
Very, very tragic. Rich Martin, or Rico as they call him, who was an outstanding hockey player, a winger for the Buffalo Sabres, and a huge community member involved in the community. Love, you know, family members, friends. I mean, my heart goes out to them. And on top of that, tragically, we also lost a trooper, Kevin Dobson, who's from the Western New York area, this past week. And again, my heart and prayers go out with his family and his friends as well. Very, very tragic to have two individuals from Western New York area and that standout pass away at such an early age, too.
All right, sorry to hear that.
Yeah, it was. Thank you.
When it comes to the budget, you're a new senator. What was it like voting on your first budget?
Well, you know, it was funny because when we were in conference the next day after the budget passed, I actually stood up in conference and I said, was that it? I mean, was that it as far as the budget? I mean, granted the painstaking process that it was, it seemed that everybody was in agreement, both in the Assembly and the Senate, to a major degree. Everybody knew it was going to be painful, so we did what we had to do to make it the least painful. We basically made a bad budget a little bit better, but we had no choice considering $14 billion was spent in the last 2 years and huge taxes and fees increased. This budget, no tax increases, no fee increases, you know, basically cutting spending, private sector job creation. That was the focus of this budget, and I think it accomplished that to a huge degree.
Right, and you eliminated a $10 billion deficit.
That's correct.
The budget spends less than last year's budget, and there's also a plan to save year to year. Tell
right.
us about that.
Yeah, there's next year's projected budget was going to be $15 billion. Now it's $2 billion. And by rejecting the tax increases and the taxes that kill jobs, we go ahead and we set ourselves up for growth for the next years that are coming. Give you an example, for these small businesses, they're going to be saving $1 billion this year and next year, then another $4 billion. So that'll help them put money back into the economy. There's going to be growth over the next year of 4% for educational. So even though the educational components had taken a hit, they're actually going to see some sort of relief in the coming years. But you know, there's a lot more that needs to be done on the educational side because besides the hits that they took in the budget, you have the property tax relief, but you have to have some mandate relief for the schools and for the government in order for all that to work together to basically be effective. Or one without the other is not going to be effective at all.
Right. So it's really about right-sizing government, and there's a number of consolidations there, too.
Lots of consolidations, commissions and authorities by 20%. And what's important is that everybody's been saying on these public authorities, you got to combine them. Duplicative services hopefully will be eliminated. Taking some other governmental entities and combining those together, a 10% cut of governmental services across the board. It's something that I think New Yorkers wanted to see because it was all coming out of their pockets. And with us taking that 10% cut across governmental lines and doing what we need to do, it shows Western New Yorkers, we understand you've taken a hit. It shows all New Yorkers, we understand you have taken a hit, and we're going to do the same thing and cut our budget.
Right. UB 2020 wasn't in the budget. Last right. week when you were on, you talked about it being a separate issue than the budget.
Right.
On the floor, when you were voting for this budget bill, you told your colleagues that it will get passed before session's out. Let's take a look at that. Okay.
One thing that I want to say to my friends across the aisle who doubt UB 2020, if you want to have and sit there and denounce the commitment of your own governor, who has stated five times in a press conference that there'll be a summit in Buffalo, you don't have to attend, that's fine. If you want to doubt what happened here in the Senate of a 55-1 vote, that's fine. But what I didn't see is I didn't see the Democrats on that side talking to their Democratic friends in the Assembly to push that bill forward as I was doing, not only with the Republicans, but meeting with Deborah Glick and other members. This bill is not dead. This bill has moved faster in the last 90 days than it has in 3 years. When the Democrats were in the majority, the bill couldn't even pass. I've been here 90 days and this bill has gone further than ever. It is not dead. We have talked to the governor. We have commitments. There's a summit. If you want to use it for political gain, that's fine. But I've talked to the people at UB 2020 about this bill. I've talked to the tradespeople, and they are ecstatic as to where UB 2020 lays at this point in time. So if you want to have shame and shoot me down for UB 2020, go ahead. We'll see what happens at the end of session. But UB 2020 is not dead. It's alive. I know it's important in Western New York, but I'm not a one-issue person. There are other things in this bill, restoring funding to Roswell Park, that the Senate did on this side, no help from the Assembly, no help from the governor. Restoration of basically Dara Martin House, Olmsted Park, Hoyt Lake projects, restoring funding to education. These are things we did on this side, and I appreciate what the Senate did, but don't doubt my word, UB 2020 is not dead. It's alive and well.
So the governor is saying that he's going to have summits on it. Explain what that is and how it's going to take place.
Well, basically, we're going to start this process right away. As a matter of fact, today's Monday, April 4th. We're meeting with the president of UB. We're going to start plans in place to have a summit gathering regarding the entire process of what UB 2020 entails and what it means for Western New York and the job creation that it'll create. But the bottom line is, you know, with him, the governor saying that it's going to happen, and then with Deborah Glick also acknowledging that UB 2020 is going to have a summit, and even Assembly Speaker Silver saying that. It's just, you know, we didn't want it. Naturally, I would like to have it in a budget, but because we didn't want to have it as a distraction and just deal with the monetary issues, we said that's fine if it's out. It's not dead. It's gone further than ever before, so we'll move it right after the budget, and that's what we plan on doing in the next couple of weeks.
Right. This budget has regional councils that Lieutenant Governor Bob Duffy will head up.
Right.
And there's a lot of other pro-jobs initiatives. Tell us how this budget deals with the private sector job growth.
Well, the business council praised this budget because they stated that it gives New Yorkers hope for growth. Some of the areas with the budget, some of the taxes and the fee increases, we eliminated those to basically help out people all across New York State. And basically, those fee and tax increases actually were killing businesses. I thought that it was appalling that not only did the last 2 years there was spent $14 billion, but they also, with the fees and the taxes and everything else, but they also eliminated the tax exemption on clothing under $55, which I thought was a travesty. So what we did was is we put that tax exemption back on. It's already gone into effect April 1st. So you get a tax break on any clothing or shoe purchases under $55, and next year that will extend to $110. That alone will help retailers sell their products and move them out the door. The PIT charges, which are going to expire at the end of this year, as I stated before, are going to save small businesses and middle-class families and workers $1 billion. So they can put it into their businesses, and it'll be $4 billion in tax relief about 2 years down the road. And a lot of people give grief, oh, why don't you put that tax back on, put it back on. I wasn't here then, but 2 years ago, the tax was put on with an expiration date. So it expires, and our commitment was not to raise taxes and not to have any new tax increases. So when it expires, it expires. If somebody wants to try to put it through on a Senate or Assembly bill, they can. But with the governor saying he wasn't going to do it, it would have been a waste of time to try to create any law whatsoever to have it done, because by the time it got to Governor Cuomo, he would have vetoed it when it passed anyway. So we were focused on the items that we knew we can get through in this year's budget process.
Right. Recharge New York. Some people know it as Power for Jobs.
Right.
This budget makes it more permanent. Tell us how it will help businesses.
Well, basically now businesses getting this Recharge New York, what was happening in the past is they would know, okay, this is what's going to happen next year with how much benefit we're going to get with some of the energy cost that they rely on. But by making it permanent, now they could balance their own budgets and their own books and have it to a point where they'll come into New York knowing that it's not going to expire a year from now. Businesses were coming here and they were saying, well, how do I have a guarantee 2 years from now that this is going to happen? Well, they didn't. Now they have a guarantee of where they're going to stand and it makes it more productive for them to bring their businesses here and create jobs in Western New York. There's a lot of room for those type of businesses. They'll come here, but New York State as a whole.
Yeah, manufacturing is benefited by that mostly, right?
Absolutely. Manufacturing is big. And we used to be big in that in Buffalo, but now we're focusing more on the lines of Buffalo Niagara Medical Corridor. There's some manufacturing jobs, especially in Niagara Falls.
What was the final outcome for the education budget?
Education budget, very happy with that. Even though it states it was cut by $1.5 billion, that is actually not correct. That included the $600 million that the federal government gave us last year, which actually expired, so we didn't get it this year. So it was about a $950 million cut that we restored in the budget, $270 million. $51 million went to special summer after-school programs. The rest was divided up regionally. Big chunk of it went to upstate New York. I fought to get some of those funds instituted in Buffalo, Niagara Falls, high-need school districts. But the biggest thing was the restoration of the funds to the 4201 schools. These are the schools for the blind, the deaf, the handicapped. Could not believe when I first read the budget that they were actually taken out and there was talk that they can go to another school. Very, very sad, but I was happy that we had full restoration of those particular fundings. And now with the property tax cap and mandate relief, not only for the cities but the school boards, hopefully all that together taken as a whole will get further relief in the educational process and help our kids achieve the best graduation rates possible.
Right. How does this budget deal with health care?
Health care, another important issue. Talked to a lot of seniors. There was complete destruction of the Epic prescription program. A lot of concerns. So what we went ahead and did is we restored two-thirds of those fundings for the Epic prescription program. And I can tell you I received phone calls already. People were very, very happy that was restored. Medicaid. A lot more needs to be done in Medicaid for the fraud and the abuse, but right now where we stand, cutting Medicaid by a percentage amount is going to help balance the books, and also in New York State.
Great. Thanks so much for being with us, Senator. We're going to end today with more of you on the floor voting for the budget.
Okay. Thank you very much.
All right.
I can tell you, my friends and colleagues, that in my district, there'll be some that are happy with this budget and some that will not. But however, this is not a time of no easy choices. In fact, they're not choices at all. Our state is in a state of chaos. I come from the private sector, and that's what my people see in my district. But I see the infant stages of turning the state around, a state that has not been friendly in the past, to taxpayers, business, and utter and complete dysfunction. This budget does not cover everyone's needs, but it does offer a new beginning to once again make this state the Empire State again. We are open for business, and instead of bickering for our own spotlight and personal needs, you need to compromise. The sooner you realize that, that we're moving in the right direction by not taxing, by creating the opportunity for job growth, cutting government waste, duplicative services, and most importantly, realizing that it is a privilege and not a right to be here representing your district. The sooner this state will be a catalyst for not only the taxpayers of New York, but the nation. History tells us that we're often looked upon as the one who will lead. Once again, we can make that a reality. As this state grows, we can all look proudly on what we accomplished, although painful as it is today. I've stated a quote, and I'll state it again. No state has ever spent themselves into prosperity. The taxes and the fees that were issued the last 2 years were ridiculous in the eyes of the voters of the people of my district. Fees that people couldn't even believe that were raised. We have to work harder and together to free up restrictions on businesses. But let's remember one thing, because I know my time is short. Our conference was not looking, and the governor was not looking, at a one-year fix to a problem. This is a fix that is carried on to the future. A $15 billion deficit next year, reduced down to $2 billion. We're not only tackling the deficit this year, but tackling the future deficits.